Welcome to worship on this Palm Passion Sunday. We are grateful that you are here. We are especially glad today that the church councils from both of our congregations are sharing in the Passion reading, and that Ellie Bush will be offering the processional gospel today. This week, the center of the church's year is one of striking contrasts. Jesus rides into Jerusalem surrounded by shouts of glory, only to be left alone to die on the cross, abandoned by even his closest friends. Mark's gospel presents Jesus in his complete human vulnerability, agitated, grieved, scared, forsaken. Though we lament Christ's suffering and all human suffering, we also expect God's salvation. Jesus promises that his death will mark a new covenant with all people. We enter this Holy Week thirsty for the completion of God's astonishing work.
The processional gospel according to Mark. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage in Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter, you will find there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say, 'The Lord needs it,' and they will send it back here immediately." They went away and found the colt tied near a door outside the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "Why are you untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said. They allowed them to take it, and they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it. And he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed the kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then they entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when they had looked around at everything, it was already late. He had went out to Bethany with his 12.
Thank you.
Everlasting God, in your endless love for the human race, you sent our Lord Jesus Christ to take on our nature and to suffer death on the cross. In your mercy, enable us to share in his obedience to your will, and in the glorious resurrection and the glorious victory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him, for they said,
Not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people.
While he was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment of nard. And she broke open the jar and poured the ointment on his head. But some were there who said to one another in anger,
"Why was the ointment wasted in this way? For this ointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii. Money given to the poor.
And they scolded her. But Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has performed a good service for me. For you always have the poor with you, and you can show kindness to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. Truly I tell you, wherever the good news is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in remembrance of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, who was one of the 12, went to the chief priests in order to betray him to them. When they heard it, they were greatly pleased and promised to give him money. So he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there."
So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them. And they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said,
"Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and to say to him, one after another,
Surely not I.
He said to them,
"It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born."
While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said,
"Take. This is my body."
Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them,
"This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them,
you will all become deserters. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him,
even though all become deserters, I will not.
Jesus said to him,
truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he said vehemently,
even though I must die with you, I will not deny you.
And all of them said the same. They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
sit here while I pray.
He took with him Peter and James and John, and he began to be distressed and agitated and said to them,
I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake.
And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if possible, the hour might pass from him. He said,
Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want.
He came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them,
are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. And with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying,
the one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.
So when he came, he went up to him at once and said,
Rabbi,
and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him. But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them,
you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled.
All of them deserted him and fled.
A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked. They took Jesus to the high priest, and all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest, and he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none, for many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying,
we heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with many hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.
But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus,
have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?
But he was silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest asked him,
are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said,
Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?
All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him,
"Prophesy."
The guards also took him over and beat him. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said,
"You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know or understand what you are talking about."
And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders,
"This man is one of them."
But again he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter,
"Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean."
But he began to curse, and he swore an oath,
"I do not know this man who you are talking about."
At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him,
"Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
He broke down and wept. As soon as it was morning, the chief priest held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered him,
"You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again,
"Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you."
But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now, at the festival, he was used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man named Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again,
"Then what do you wish me to do with the man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
Crucify
him.
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more,
Crucify him.
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him.
"Hail, the king of the Jews."
King of the Jews.
They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying,
He would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Save yourself and come down from the cross.
In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying,
He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe.
Those who were crucified with him also taunted him. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which means,
my God, why have you forsaken me?"
When some of the bystanders heard it, they said,
Listen, he is calling for Elijah.
And someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying,
Let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down.
Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said,
"Truly, this man was God's son."
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph and of Salome. They used to follow him and provided for him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When evening had come, and since it was the day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate wondered if he were already dead. And summoning the centurion when he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the body to Joseph. Then Joseph bought a linen cloth, and taking down the body, wrapped it in the linen cloth and laid it in a tomb that had been hewn out of the rock. He then rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid. Here ends the reading of the Passion of our Lord.
Good morning. It's time for the children's sermon. So I'd like to invite all the kids to scooch closer to your screens. Make sure that you can see and hear me. All right, so today is a pretty big day. It's Palm Sunday. So you might remember sometimes where you've come to church before where you get these big green palms and you get to walk around the sanctuary and wave them all around. That's the day we're thinking of, okay? You with me? Cool. All right, so think with me for a minute. When you have people come over to your house, maybe it's friends or family members who don't live in town, do you have to do anything to get ready for them? I know I did. So when I was a kid, growing up, if I wanted to have a friend over, I had to make sure that my room was clean before me and my friends would play with all the toys and make it messy again. Do any of you have to do that? And now that I'm all grown up and I have a house, I decide to clean before people come over. So I might do some dusting or sweeping. Maybe I clean my counters. Do you guys do anything like that? How do you prepare to have guests over? Well, Palm Sunday is all about this big day where people were preparing for Jesus. They waved palm branches around. Some people even took off their coats and laid them on the ground so that the donkey that Jesus was riding on wasn't walking on the dirt. They did all those things to prepare for Jesus to come. That's pretty special, isn't it? And of course, Palm Sunday means we are only 1 week away from Easter, which is a big thing to prepare for. Jesus does some pretty neat stuff for us, right? Because he loves us so much. So this week, as we're thinking about Palm Sunday and moving into Easter, I want you to think about how you prepare your hearts for Jesus to accept all that love, how you can prepare for others to love them, make sure everything is ready for them to arrive. Do you think you can do that? All right, let's pray about it just to make sure. Okay, let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. Thank you for this exciting day of Palm Sunday to remind us to prepare for Jesus and to prepare for one another. Help us to be more like Jesus and to love everyone. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Bye, guys. Have a good week.
Happy Palm Sunday.
Yeah, so grace, mercy, and peace, beloved ones, from God who we follow and who goes before us now into Jerusalem on this Palm Sunday. I was thinking this week, Pastor Elizabeth, about how this is the second year now that we will not do Palm Sunday as we have always done it.
Right.
With the pandemic where it is yet, and while we know soon, we pray, we hope soon we'll be at a different place. In terms of being together in one place, we are not there yet.
Nope.
Yeah. So this year, again, you and I are doing this conversation on Zoom, and we'll be gathering with some of the faithful ones in a parking lot to mark Palm Sunday and Easter as well. But I got thinking this week about the things I miss about it, and how, at least in this place, how we've always done it, how God's people gather in the atrium, they pick up their palms, they're standing close to one another, leaning over, talking to each other, the children, all that energy is everywhere, right? That as it gets close to 9 o'clock, I climb the stairs and invite the children to come up with me, and they come up with their palms, they're kind of gathered close. I usually talk to them about some meaning of the day, whether it's why we're carrying palms or the meaning of Hosanna, which is a plea for God to save us. And then one of our children will get up on a stool and read the processional gospel. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. The organ starts to play. Oh, glory, laud, and honor. People make their way up the stairs.
We sing,
yeah. Yeah, trying to keep up with where the organ is, right? Because we're outside of the sanctuary at that point. But kids march around, find our way to our places.
Make a parade.
Make a parade, exactly. Not play acting, but in a way, acting out what happened so long ago on that first fateful Palm Sunday.
Right.
Yeah, and I miss that. And I'm eager for the time when we're able to do that again, as we're accustomed to.
Yeah. Of course, that parade, your parade that you're speaking of, was almost better planned than this parade Jesus put together.
This one seems pretty spontaneous that we hear about today, doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah, as though the people didn't quite know what was happening and all of a sudden it was happening. Yeah.
Even the disciples, they were just outside of Jerusalem, and Jesus said, go
get the colt, which is tied up outside, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, tell them that the master's in need of it, bring it to me, and then they do.
Right? And they do.
Yeah.
And what must people have been thinking in the crowd?
I mean, any other royal parade they would have seen wouldn't have looked quite like this one, would it?
No. And, on the other side of town, Pilate had just come in on a horse with cohorts and
a war horse, if you will. Yeah. Right? Yeah. 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 So, yeah. So there's a way in which it's an ironic imitation of that, kind of, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, Pilate came in the way he did to intimidate.
Yeah, exactly. To remind who was in charge, right? And Jesus was not, that was not his call. Correct. Yeah. But one of the things I know, at least in our ongoing conversation in places I've served, has always been the kind of the contrast between how we do Palm Sunday today and the way we did it when we were kids. And I remember that as well. So I'm getting up there. So I'm a part of that generation that has a different memory of before we read the reading of the Passion right in the middle.
Exactly.
When we when our childhood memories was of Palm Sunday being a very joyful day.
Nothing right? But palms and happiness and singing.
Yeah.
And
yeah, yeah. But I kind of wonder if maybe that whole conversation, I wonder if we were missing the point then of Palm Sunday a little. Maybe there isn't something even in that short processional gospel in Mark that we hear today that points to what's coming next. Maybe we weren't ready to hear it when we were children.
Right, right.
Maybe all that this last year has held makes me more ready to hear it now. I don't know. Because there's nothing royal in this procession, really, except for Jesus.
And he goes right to the temple.
Uh-huh.
Apparently just walks in and looks around.
Exactly, yeah.
Turns around.
And walks out again, yeah.
You know, doesn't do anything. It makes you wonder why he was going there. So he came with some sort of a purpose. It wasn't to stay at the temple. It was too late.
Mm-hmm. Certainly with a purpose, but it's not stated exactly.
No.
And you hear a few chapters before in Mark's gospel about what's to come next, that prediction of Jesus suffering and death, right?
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't say that here.
Right.
Yeah. And yet I'm struck by the kind of the minor undertones of this, that you know, Pilate in his procession, no, somebody else was making the preparations, right?
Absolutely.
Jesus is doing the work here. He comes in on a colt, not a war steed, a big horse or, you know, chariot or something.
Right.
Right. That his ride is cushioned by the cloaks of the people. How interesting is that?
And yet he is a king.
Yeah, he is a king, but clearly a different kind of king.
Clearly a different kind.
Yeah.
And the crowd is shouting a different refrain.
Yeah.
Save us.
Yeah. Yeah. And I wonder this year as we shout or whisper Hosanna wherever we may be, if that has more meaning to us now than it did a year ago. For many of us, you think?
That and this Palm Passion Sunday, for me, it's always been hard to make that turn. It seems so abrupt.
Mm-hmm.
Because we go right into the Passion reading.
Yes.
This year, it doesn't seem abrupt.
Hmm. Why is that?
Well, this year, I feel like maybe we've been going through the 3 days all year.
For all year. It feels like it's been Holy Week or the Triduum, right? All week, yeah. All year long. Yeah.
All week long.
Yeah. So maybe that allows us to hear it differently this time. Maybe that which cushioned me from it has been torn away a little bit. So I can hear and see things more clearly than I could. Maybe that's part of the gift of this.
Yeah, I would just try to observe in yourself. Imagine you're part of the crowd,
mm-hmm.
wondering about this Jesus, about what he has done, about why he's coming in this way.
Yeah.
Because now in the Passion reading, which we will turn to shortly.
Yes.
We are again the crowd.
We are the crowd. Exactly. So where do we fit in that crowd? And what do we see happening before us now as our church councils share the reading of the Passion in this way to this year?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, may we all be deeply blessed in that. May God use this unusual Palm Sunday, Holy Week to help us to grow deeper in faith and trust of him.
Help us to be ready. Blessed is Jesus. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Amen.
Amen.
Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. In Jesus, you came among us as a suffering servant. Give your church humility. Redeem your people from pride and the certainty that we always know your will. Heal us and empower us to confess Christ crucified. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great. In creation, life springs from death. Redeem your creation awaiting resurrection. Restore lost habitats and endangered species. Create new possibilities for areas affected by climate change. Grant relief from natural disasters and nurture new growth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Jesus was handed over to the powers of this world. In all nations, instruct the powerful that they would not exploit their power, but maintain justice. Sustain soldiers and guide those who command them, that they serve those in greatest need. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
On the cross, Jesus joined all who feel forsaken. Abide with those who are condemned to death. Defend those who are falsely accused. Console and strengthen those who are mocked or bullied. Accompany all who suffer, especially those who grieve the victims of mass shootings in Atlanta, Georgia, and Boulder, Colorado. Grant respite and renewal. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You called followers to tend Jesus' body in death. Sustain hospice workers and funeral directors. Bless this congregation's ministries at times of death, those who plan and lead funerals, those who prepare meals, all who offer support in grief. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You inspire the centurion to confess Jesus as your son. We praise you for the faith you have given to people of all places and times. Give us also such faith to trust the promises of baptism and, with them, to look for the resurrection of the dead. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My kingdom come, thy name. Blessing. You are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, freed to serve your neighbor. God bless you that you may be a blessing in the name of the Holy and life-giving Trinity. Amen. Go in peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God.